first thing I want to talk to you about is this bowl. Okay? There's a reason behind it, trust me. So this bowl, I made this by myself. Well, Jeff helped a little bit, but mostly I did by myself. We don't count what he did, because really. So they always tell me pastors need hobbies, right? Because you need to have a way to kind of unwind sometimes. And so I began trying to find a hobby. And so I thought I'd get into woodworking, because I liked woodworking. And so I made that cross, right? And then I recognized I didn't really like woodworking all that much. It's okay, but it's not really. I preferred wood carving. When I was a kid, there was this old man, my friend, he was my friend's grandfather. And he lived with his grandparents. And they lived diagonal from my house. And he used to carve ducks. And so my friend and I would just kind of sit in the garage and watch him carve ducks. And he gave me a few carving tools when I was a real little, just kind of those like that, like a $6 kit you can buy at Home Depot or whatever. And I remember kind of whittling sticks and kind of thing. And so that kind of came back to me when I was trying to find a hobby. And so one day I started out with just this little block, and I made a ball in a box, right? I just took a block of wood and carved a ball out of it, and there's a ball in a box. And then I made a couple spoons. And then I said, okay, now I'm going to make a bowl. One day after I dropped Madison off of school, I saw a guy in his front yard, and he had a big pile of wood, and he was splitting it. And I said, okay, well, I'll pull in his driveway, and I said, hey, any chance I can get a half a log? He said, for what? So, well, I'm trying to, get into carving. I'm looking to carve a bowl. Is there any chance? And he goes, yeah, sure, pick out which one you want. And so I scoured, and I found this piece. It's this beautiful piece of black walnut. The reason why I liked it is because as it was a whole log, I can see that it had two different colors to it. Like, I didn't stain that. That's just the natural color of the wood. And so I picked it out, and he cut it for me. He split it for me, and I took it home. And I stripped the bark off of it. I cleaned up the bottom of it because, after he had split it, it had some splinters on. It was pretty jagged, so I cleaned that up a little bit. I have a tool called an adze. It's just kind of like an axe, but it's curved, and you swing it. And so you use it to kind of hollow out a bowl. And so I began to do that, and I had it about that big. And it was pretty deep, and I thought that was pretty good. So then I began to use some of my gouges and kind of cleaned it up a little bit and recognized that it's not that great yet. So I continued to bring the adze out and work. And then I took my axe, because when this thing started, it was about as wide as this table. No joke. How wide is this table? And maybe about that long. So about that long and as wide as the table. So I took my axe and I began trying to cut out the corners. And that's when I realized I was in trouble. So that's when I called Jeff and said, hey, any way I can come over? And he used a chainsaw and helped kind of cut those corners off. And so basically, you had just a flat piece with four corners cut off of it. So then I began to use a tool called a draw knife, which is a straight blade. It's got two handles, and you just draw. And it just takes out a nice big chunks of wood. And so I began to use the draw knife to get it into form and to get out the marks from the chainsaw and the marks from the axe, and use my gouges on the inside to get out the marks from the adze. And the bowl began to take shape. I then used my adze to kind of put in these little handles here, and then use my gouges to clean that up. And then I was done. So then I began to sand. And I started out with 150 grit sandpaper, and I just sanded. And sanded and sanded and sanded and sanded and did the inside and the outside and just sanded and sanded and sanded. And then I graduated to a 220 grit sandpaper. And I just sanded and sanded and sanded. Sanded and sanded and sanded. And then I graduated to a 300 level sandpaper. I think it's 330 or something like that. And it's processed all over again. Then I went to a 400 level sandpaper. I did the process all over again. And then I looked at it and I said, it's done. So then I took some boiled linseed oil, and I began to rub it down with this boiled linseed oil. Boiled linseed oil, basically, it penetrates the pores of the wood and then hardens. So it's nice and hard, but it's sealed. But it's a natural sealant. And then I wiped all that, the excess of that off, and I said, it's done. And I began this process sometime first part of September. And the day I put the linseed oil on it and said it was done was the Tuesday before Thanksgiving. A 3-month process that I spent making this bowl. A couple reasons why I made this bowl. I made this bowl for my mother-in-law. Most of you know my mother-in-law, so you would know that she absolutely loves this bowl. She actually didn't want to give it back to me to bring it in here today. But I made it because I knew no matter how bad it looked, she was going to love it. So no matter how bad it looked, at the end, she was going to tell me it was beautiful, no matter what it looked like. And so when I started out to make it, I said, okay, well, I'm going to make it for her. Dort has always been very supportive of all my artistic endeavors, including my illicit candle making. Debbie will have to tell you about that. It's not a church-appropriate story. And so, you know, when I was thinking about it, I wanted to do something, but what am I going to do with it? This isn't really my style. It's not going to go in our house, but, you know, this is the kind of stuff that Dort has in her house, and she'll love it. So I made it for her. I knew over the process of making this bowl, before it even began, I knew I was going to love the bowl. But I also knew how much she was going to love receiving the bowl. And then I made the bowl, and then I loved the bowl. And I didn't really want to give it away. But I'd already told Madison it was for her grandma Odort, and so therefore I couldn't really go back. But I made the bowl because I knew I would love making the bowl. But then I loved the bowl because of all the time I spent making the bowl. I literally put my blood and my sweat in this bowl. Standing over this thing, hitting it with the ads, sweat dripping off of my face into the bowl. The gouges are usually pretty razor sharp, and so I cut myself, and you don't even know. Like, I didn't even know I'd cut myself. And next thing I know, I look down, and there's blood on my hand, and there's blood in the wood, and so now I had to cut that out. So I literally put my sweat and my blood inside of this bowl. And I absolutely fell in love with making this bowl. All right, so now you know how good of a woodcarver I am. That's not the sermon. I just wanted to tell you about the bowl I made. No, that had nothing to do with the sermon. That was just, I just wanted to brag about how great I was. So last week, for those who have been paying attention, and those who were here last week, you should know, because it kind of made you pay attention. There's only like 10 of you, because most of you guys party too much New Year's Eve, apparently. Apparently I have a bad church. Yeah. It's okay. And Kathy and Milo were sick. I know it makes people sick after New Year's. Right, Milo? So I decided finishing up last year, that this year I was going to spend mostly in the Old Testament. I would say I'm going to spend the whole year in the Old Testament, but I don't know, and I'm not going to limit the Holy Spirit. I might have a Sunday where the Holy Spirit puts something on my heart out of the New Testament. I'm not going to say I can't do that, Holy Spirit, because I told the people I was only, but for the most part this year we're going to be in the Old Testament. We're going to try to go through as much of the Old Testament as we possibly can, trying to find this God that I've been explaining for this last year. And so last week, since we decided we're going to start in the Old Testament, we decided we'd start in Genesis. And since we decided to start in Genesis, we decided we'd start with Genesis 1. And since we decided to start in Genesis 1, we decided to start with Genesis 1:1, and we got as far as in the beginning. That's as far as we made it last week, so you didn't miss a whole lot, so don't feel bad. So we're going to pick back up. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So today we're going to talk more about creation and what God created. Now, typically, our churches tend to be pretty academic. We get into the what's and the how's and the when's. And as you know, over our journey of this last year, I don't really care a whole lot about that. I want to know about the why's. right? We get into that first, and what we call the first and second eye seeing from Richard Rohr about the what's and the hows and the whens. And then we can move into the third eye seeing as to the why, which is what God is doing in this and what God is trying to tell us through this. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time reading Genesis 1 because, you know, we've heard it. We know that on this day he did this, and this day he did this, and this day he did this, and then after six of those things, on the seventh day he rested, right? And I'm not making light of it, okay? And I'm not saying that that's irrelevant. We've read that before. We've read that many, many times. And we have some other things that we want to talk about today. So we also want to be in a little bit out of Genesis 2, and we'll come back to that here in a minute. But when I started to think that in the beginning God created, and then I asked why God created. Now, we know that there's some disagreement with some of you and me as to the winds, right? Some of you want to believe that it happened 6,000 years ago, and that's fine. You can believe that. You're wrong, but it's okay. You can believe that. Some people believe that the universe began being formed 13.8 billion years ago. Some people, it's 14.3. Once again, we're not talking about the winds and the why, or the winds and the hows. But at some point in time, there was this God, and God stood, and in John 1, we know that in the beginning was the Word, and this is one of the reasons why John, in John's Gospel, goes before the beginning. He goes all the way back before Adam, before Abraham, before everybody. He goes before the beginning. He says, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. With, there is the word pros, which means face to face. Okay, so it's not like they're just hanging out. They're standing face to face looking at each other. And now, because of our dualistic minds, we're going to have a hard time understanding this next part, but they were actually face to face to face. And you say, well, you three people can't stand face to face. Well, it's because you're limited in your understanding because of the binary concept of your mind. But these three people that were so in love with each other that they were literally face to face to face, and so they were in this point, and I'm not going to go into the science of it. I already did that, and Ann hated it, but it's okay. But we know that there's a point in time when there was so much love between these three that they just exploded. I believe it is 7 sextillion tons of force. They exploded out of love. God did not create because he wanted to be loved. He already had a whole lot of love between the three of them. God created because he wanted to love. God created because he knew how much he was going to love creating. And God created because he knew how much he was going to love the creation. And so, we have a little bit of a chicken and the egg scenario. What came first, the chicken or the egg? You can't have an egg unless you have a chicken, but you can't have a chicken unless you have an egg. So, did God create because he loved, or did he love because he created? And the answer is yes. I knew I was going to love the bowl, and I made the bowl, and I loved the bowl. But I loved it because I made it. I've been told a lot, and I believe it to be true from my own experience, that a mother becomes a mother when she gets pregnant. A father becomes a father the first time he holds his child. And so one day when Jessica surprised me to let me know that she was pregnant, once again, Madison wasn't a mistake or an accident. She was just a surprise. And so I got that surprise, and I was excited, but I didn't really feel like I thought I was going to feel when I found out I was going to be a father. I knew I was going to love her. I loved thinking about having a daughter one day. But then I thought, well, maybe once I hear her heartbeat, that's when it'll hit me. And so we went to the doctor one time, and we heard her heartbeat for the first time, and I said, I was excited, but it didn't really change much. I was still just the old selfish me that I'd always been. And then I said, well, when I see the ultrasound, that's when I'll change. That's when it'll hit me. And so then we saw the ultrasound, and it was cool, it was exciting. I knew I was gonna love her, but it didn't change me like I thought it would. And I said, well, the first time I feel the baby kick, the first time I think that the baby knows it's daddy and it kicks, right? Because that's what we tell her. Well, they knew it was me, that's why it kicked, right? No, it was just in there swimming around and its foot kicked. But whatever, I believed it, and I still do. She kicked because she knew it was me. I thought, but that's when I thought, that's when I'll feel it. And so the first time I felt her kick, it was exciting, and I was excited, but nothing really changed inside of me. I still knew that I was going to love her. And I loved the whole process of making her with Jessica. I'm talking about Jessica's pregnant, seeing Jessica get bigger, taking care of Jessica, putting the room together. I loved that entire process. And I knew at the end of it I was going to love her, but I hadn't fallen in love with her yet. And then the doctor delivers the baby, and she gets onto Jessica, and I don't know if you're familiar with the kangaroo care, but she just moves right down and starts nursing. It's the most incredible thing I've ever seen in my life. And then they take her and they clean her off, and next thing you know, the doctor hands her to me. And I said, oh, there it is. That's what I've been waiting to feel. And then the first time she opened her eyes and looked at me, I said, oh, that's there. That wasn't it before. That's it. And then the first time she grabbed my finger, I said, oh, that is it. And it all is it. It's just me continuing to fall deeper and deeper. The first time she looked at me and says, Daddy, I love you. I was like, ah, broken. Just broken. That's that feeling. And so when Jessica and I decided to have another kid, I knew I was going to love the kid. I knew I was going to love the process of having the kid come into the world. But I knew that I wasn't. That once I had him in my hands, that's when I was going to love him. And for me, that begins to help us understand creation. And it begins to help us see that God is different. In some ways. In some ways, different than the way that we have perceived him, and the way that we explain him, and the way that we understand him. Recently, Jeff and I were having a conversation, and he was talking to tell me about a conversation he was having with somebody about Christianity and Islam. And he asked me, he says, do the Muslims worship the same God that we do? And I said, yes. And I think I might have surprised him a little bit. But it's historically, it's true. Jews, Muslims, and Christians all worship the God of Abraham. Jews and Christians worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Muslims worship the God of Abraham and Ishmael, right? We recognize the scripture that says that Isaac was the first and true heir of Abraham. They say, no, it's Ishmael, right? But all of it, it doesn't matter. It's still the God of Abraham that all three religions worship. That's why Islam, Christianity, and Judaism are called the Abrahamic religions. But the main difference between even Judaism, Islam, and us is that they go to an altar and they make sacrifices to God. Today, we're going to come to an altar and you're going to receive the sacrifice that God made for you. Israel's biggest problem, the biggest problem that Israel has in the Old Testament is God constantly saying to Israel, I am going to love you. And Israel said, oh, no, 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 you're not. We're going to love you. And God said, you can't. I made you so I can love you. And I'm going to serve you. And they said, no, 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 no. We're going to serve you and we're going to love you. And what happened? Time and time and time again. When we understand that God spent time creating us. Now, I could come up here and I could spend 45 minutes giving a very good, accurate sermon that would be biblically accurate and true to the Hebrew, demonstrating that the 6 days of creation in Genesis are six literal 24-hour periods, and I could have sources and credibility to back me up and to enough proof to say that I'm right. However, I could also do the exact same thing and come up here and tell you that the days of creation aren't six literal 24-hour periods, but six spans of time, or six periods, six epochs from the Hebrew, and be true in the same sense. I'm not trying to convince you one way or the other. If you want to believe it was six literal days, you can. I tend to believe that it's six periods, because day doesn't always mean a 24-hour period, and I'll say that because verse 4 of Genesis 2, it says, "This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God made heaven and earth." So it's either in the day, specific 24-hour period, or in the time, right? Because you always say, well, back in my day. Do you mean back in the one day of your life? Or do you mean back in this period of time of my life? Back in this era of my life, this is what I did. And one of the reasons why I believe that it wasn't just a literal 24-hour period is because, first of all, I believe that God could just poof, and there's Adam. I absolutely believe he could do that. I don't believe he did. One of the reasons why I don't believe he did is because I believe that God loves the process of creating. I could have made that bowl a lot faster. I could have gotten a lathe and some tools on a lathe, spun it on a lathe, and just sat there and been done with it in a day. I don't want to do that. I wanted to spend my time crafting this bowl with my hands, and because I knew I was going to love the process of creating. And so when we read, Genesis 2, verse 4, it says, again, this is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made heaven and earth. Now no shrub of the field was yet in the earth, no plant of the field had yet sprouted, for the Lord God had not sent rain upon the earth. But there was no man to cultivate the ground, cultivate the earth. But a mist used to raise from the earth and water the whole surface of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living being. So, once again, I'm not going to get into the whole science diatribe, but basically and generically, when we talk about the origins of life, we talk about the fact that somehow, some way, life was formed. And we talk about it was formed as it was a bacteria or whatever, and we know that bacteria needs about four things to grow. It needs a food source, it needs moisture, it needs warmth, and it needs time. The main two things there are, A, it needs food, which is dirt, and it needs moisture. And it just says that God had nothing was growing because there was no water. Then he had this mist come out of the ground. So now we have moisture, and the moisture mixes with the dirt. And God begins to use this dirt and this moisture, and he brings them together into particles, and he brings the particles into atoms, and the atoms into molecules, and the molecules into cells, and then he builds other cells, and he puts it all together, and he spends his time crafting a foot to be the perfect human technology is the foot. And then he makes a kneecap. And then he makes a hip bone, and then he gets to the eye. And think about how much time he spent making the eye, because he wanted the eye to be able to appreciate and understand the beauty of his creation. And if you also think the fact that God made a tree, do I think that God could say, poof, there's a tree? I do, but I don't believe it's what he did. Why? Because Scripture says he planted seeds, and then he had moisture come out of the ground and water the seeds, and then they grew. And I think that God took his time putting life into that seed. He put personality in the seed, because different trees have different bark textures, they have different color leaves, they have different leaf patterns, they have, they're different in all of the trees. And you think God just said, poof, there's trees? Or did God spend his time crafting and making these trees and making pear trees and apple trees and orange trees all for us? God is a God of creation, and he's still creating, because I am not done creating. God began creating me one day, and he formed in his mind, he formed an image of me in his mind, and then he fell in love with that image, and then he began to create me in that image. And he is still working on that. His creation of me is not completed. It's still continuing. So you say, well, he created Adam in one day. And then he was done. could be true. Several weeks ago, we were talking, we had one of our discussions, and some people were questioning me on some of the things, and I think Debbie said, you gotta be careful, people are gonna think you believe in evolution. I do. And you all went, it's okay. I have the video, and there was a, it's on YouTube. But I asked the question, I said, did Adam and Eve just show up one day as full-grown human beings? And Jessica said, well, why couldn't they have? They could have. I don't think they did. Did Jesus just show up one day as a full-grown human being? Did you just show up one day as a full-grown human being? So why does Adam get to avoid puberty and you don't? Why does Adam get to avoid adolescence, but Jesus has to go through it? Doesn't make a whole lot of sense. But once again, inside of the bubble, inside of the boxes that we've created for ourselves, and you say, live inside the box, don't ask about anything outside the box, and don't question anything inside the box, it all makes sense that one day there's just Adam and Eve walking around hanging out with a full conscience and an understanding of everything around them. But it doesn't make sense in the narrative that I made a bowl and I spent my time making the bowl because I loved the bowl. I spent my time crafting and creating this bowl. And guess what? This bowl was made in my image. But it looks nothing like you, you say. But in... Well, I'm pretty sure we'll get to that in a minute. But in my mind, I had an image of what I wanted this bowl to look like. Now, I didn't have any drawings. I didn't have any drafts. I didn't have any templates. I had an image in my mind, and I made a bowl. I didn't measure anything. As you can see, this handle's longer than this handle. This side is steeper than this side. It's not symmetrical. It's not perfect, right? But it's okay. I didn't want it to be. I wanted it to look like me, not symmetrical, not perfect. And you say, well, you're in great shape. Pear's a shape, right? I understand. But anybody who knows me can look at this bowl and say, yeah, he probably made that. That looks like something he would make. Because it's not perfect. It's got my personality. It was made in my image. Well, so was Adam. And I believe that God spent his time making Adam, crafting him out of the mud that came from the dirt and came from the moisture. And then when he was completed, he breathed inside of him the breath of life, which I will believe and I will proclaim is the Holy Spirit. He breathed inside of him the Holy Spirit, because we say the Holy Spirit is the breath of life. Now the difference is in order for me to make this bowl, this tree had to die. I don't have life. I can't breathe life into this bowl. God probably could. But he created out of nothing. I created out of something. And then when he was done, he breathed life into it. Why? Because he loved the process of making it. And when he was done, he loved what he had made. Now, we have to recognize that this love of God is a different love than we understand. This is what we call pure agape love. Other-centered, self-giving. Everything that God does, he does for you to benefit, and even if it costs him a sacrifice. Right? Other-centered, self-giving. We always talk about Jesus died on the cross, but what we forget is that God died on the cross. God gave himself into our hands and allowed us to kill him in order to give us his own love. He sacrificed, he gave of himself for you to be loved by him. Other-centered, self-giving love. We do not love, and I'm not saying you can't love God and we don't love God. I'm saying the objective is not for you to love God. The objective is for you to be loved by God. The objective is not for you to make sacrifices and to serve God. The objective is for you to receive sacrifices and to be served by God. Several weeks ago, I was talking about marriage, and we were talking about my wife, and I said, the best way in which my wife can serve me is by letting me love her. The best way that you can serve God is just by allowing God to love you. That pure, agape, other-centered, self-giving love. That's why he created, that's what you were created for. God did not make you because he wanted to sit on the throne and be worshipped and be loved and be served. God made you because he wanted somebody to love and he wanted somebody to serve. That is this book from Genesis to Revelation. That's the difference in understanding the whys of creation. I don't care about the what's and the when's and the how's. I want to know why. Because the understanding that we have been telling people doesn't make sense when you actually read the book and stop being told what the book says by somebody who went to school and had somebody tell them what it says. But when you actually read what it says something completely different. It says that God made you because he loves you. I made that bowl for two reasons. One, it's two parts, because I knew I was going to love making the bowl, and I knew I was going to love the bowl. The second reason I made the bowl is because I knew how much the person receiving the bowl was going to love the bowl. I sacrificed, I gave of myself to bless somebody else. Why did God make my wife? God made my wife because he knew how much he was going to love making her, how much he was going to love her, and he knew how much I was going to love receiving her. That's God. And so what do we do with that? We use that same agape love. That same love, and we try to be centered on others and giving to others. Not necessarily to him, because what's the best way in which we can serve God? By letting God love us. And if we allow God to love us, then we are going to begin to love what God created, and we're going to begin to pour ourselves out in love for the other people. I didn't forget about communion. This is the table. This is our altar, where we come to receive the sacrifice that God made for us. So today, in a few minutes here, when you come up and you receive these elements, I want you to recognize and understand that this is what God sacrificed for you. You are receiving the body that was broken for you. You are receiving the blood that was spilled out for you. Not to make you drones who just follow and just go to church every Sunday, but was spilt and was broken for you to be able to have a relationship with the Father who created you and the Father who loved you. And then when you come and you take these elements, you then ask, because we're told, right? Gotta try to be like God. So how do we be like God? We love the way he loves. So when you receive these elements, you ask yourself, how can I be broken for the betterment of the body? How can I be spilled out for the betterment of the body? How can I give of myself for something that is centered and focused on somebody else? How could I love in the same way that God loves? Other-centered, self-giving. Because that is the core of creation. God created because there was a time when it was just him, face to face to face with him. And he was so full of love, he says, there's way too much love for just the three of us. Boom! Let's create so we can love. Not be loved, not be served, but to serve and to love. I believe God spent his time crafting Adam. And I think he spent a lot more than just a day making Adam. Because if he just spent a day making Adam, it doesn't make sense how much he loved him. He spent way more than a day creating me, and I don't think he loves me any more than he loves Adam. I don't care. If you want to believe 6,000 years, if you want to believe 6 literal days, that's fine. But just understand the why it all happened. Why did he create? So please come forward. Take. We have the bread, the juice. Stand just first row, come and go back. Intinction style. But really spend the time contemplating, understanding that this is God's sacrifice to you. Not necessarily, he didn't sacrifice for you. He's making a sacrifice to you. And then how can you sacrifice for others? Amen?